If that room's available, I'll keep coming. Do what? Move in quick. No, I've... Yeah, it's been set aside for me. So go ahead and get married. You can't back out, Freddie. So no, it's you're stuck with me no matter what. Some of you are happy. It's a funny story. Teaching is awesome. It's all these amazing young college students, amazing stuff they're doing. And I was going a while. I know you find that hard to believe. And so I said, I've gone a while. And I'm just going to say it. All the black students went, go ahead, you keep going. And I just said, none of the white students just said, go ahead. And some of you, it's just true. It just, that's the way it happened. I don't know why I shared that with you, but. just want to tell you about a few things on our table. I'm just fascinated that God gives us the ability to think like Him. In any situation you're in, you get to think like Him. But you have to access that certainly doesn't cost anything, but you must choose to think like that. And I love the Isaiah says, my thoughts are not your thoughts. Have you ever noticed that? But you're required to think like Him if you're going to be fruitful. And so one of my questions, I have constant questions to the Lord, is how do you walk in the mind of Christ? So I have a whole series on that. And how you think determines your future. So that's back there. One amen for that. And this is a new series. We didn't have it last year. It's called Living the Ascended Lifestyle. You, as a born-again creature with the seed of God inside of you, you were made to see above every circumstance that you're in. And that you can actually live with rest and peace no matter the turmoil that's in front of you. And it's the privilege of every believer to actually live from a place of rest. And there's a cool message in there, governed by truth, living a prophetic lifestyle, and then learning to define your environment. So that's back there. If you want to buy that, that'll be half off tonight. And then I'm telling you, really, I wouldn't just say this. You really need to buy this book. It's not by me. It's by one of my fathers in my life, Dale Mass. It's called And David Perceived That He Was King. It's the best book I've ever read on identity. Really, really encourage you to get it. If you buy it with my series on David, that alone is 28, and we'll give that to 30. But if you buy my book, if you haven't bought my book, you can repent tonight for your backslidden state. And the Lord is always loving and gracious to everybody. And so you can buy both of these for 25 back there. So, and if you've ever felt part of being in the kingdom is it starts in Genesis 1, and He blessed them. It's part of being in the kingdom. He made them in His image, and He blessed them. And so you always, part of being a son and daughter, is you want to be a blessing to the world around you. But then I find in my life, there are people that you connect with that you know are part of your divine destiny. And for me, I have a number of those that not only through our ministry, but personally. And I find by my partnership with them, it adds a dimension from the grace on their life into my life. And so if you sense that from us, we would love for you to consider partnering with us. We really need partners to do certain things that the Lord's called us to do. And you can see, also, if you don't want to partner with us, but you just want to follow what's going on, we will email you and we will bother you if you sign up for our mailing list. Just say that. Tracy said, we won't bother you. We bother you if you're on our mailing list because we figure you want to be bothered. So so that's all back there. There's a lot of things not right about me. I do feel like I have a word from you, but I just want to minister to a few people. There's this couple. You said you met them before service. You go to Randy's church. New Heritage. They want to sell a house. They're going through some things. You have some. How long you've had this condition where you believe in God for healing for?
Over 10 years.
So why don't you just stand? Why don't you stretch your hands towards them? You guys stand. And we'll just stretch your hands towards them. And your names?
Robert.
Susanna. Robert and Susanna. Father, I just could put my hand on your shoulder. Is that okay?
Sure.
I'm gonna put my hand on. Whoa! Thank you, Lord. First of all, I just release all the weight, all the worry. The Lord says, daughter, you don't need to worry. You don't need to fear. Be at rest. And I close that door of worry and I replace it with the yoke of God and I release the breath of God. And as I just did that prophetic act, I just saw like the fire of God going through your legs, going through your fire of God. I command healing in your body tonight, that you have come here for a specific purpose, and that is not only healing of your body, but healing of your mind. And Father, I stand in agreement. We call this house sold. Sold to the highest bidder. Father, from the north, the south, the east, and the west, we call a buyer for this home. I free the both of you from the need to think you have to sell it yourself. And I just see Jesus anointing your eyes so you can see him. So I bless your eyes to see the beauty of the Lord. And I say to you that this will be a season encounter like you've never known. And when I saw Jesus touch your eyes, I saw him put his hand on your chest. And he says, you're going to understand my goodness towards you in a way you never have. And it's even in this season, the Lord is going to, just through his embrace of you, even break things off that the enemy put on you as a child. So we say, go today and tonight, and will of God be done. And everything you came here tonight to receive, you'll go and you'll leave differently. In Jesus' name. Do you know, this house, it's going to be a place where people just come. Some will feel connected here, but it'll be a house where people just come. Some will drive from 5-6 hours away, and they'll just come one night, and they'll receive a divine transfer and transaction from the Lord. Because there's a well of glory. There's a well of anointing. So I just declare that from the north, the south, the east, and the west. Thank you, Lord, for the release of the angelic host to bring people who need to receive from what God is doing here. And let transformation happen to their mind in Jesus' name. What's your name again there? Sweetheart? What's your name? Yeah, you. Valerie, that's right. How old are you, Valerie? 21, you got a call to the nations on your life. You got a missions call on your life. And God's hand, that's why God's hand's been on your life. And the Lord says he just wants you to himself in this season. And that there's a lot of desires that you have in your heart, but they're all just hidden in the narrow path with him. And he invites you. It's not a narrow path bad, but it's where all your priorities are hidden in him. And out of that, the desires of your heart will come to pass. There's a miracle anointing on your life. And there's a prophetic gift, a seeing prophetic gift on your life. And you're going to enter a season. I see you stepping into a season of dreaming like never before. Ricky, right? Ricky, do you know, sometimes the enemy lies to us and convinces us that other people deserve certain things, and because of the choices we've made in life and because of where we're at in life, we'll never fulfill the dreams. But the Lord said, son, begin to dream again. Even begin to dream. I want to bring you back to dreams you even had as a child. And you just see yourself, well, I'm just going to make do where I'm at. And the Lord says, I've never called you to make do. I want to cause you to dream, and I want to cause you to be an example of the goodness of God. And I want to cause you to be a testimony to your family, that when you go back to your family, that they'll say, truly there is a God, because we've seen the transformation and we've seen the goodness of God on behalf of this man. Hey, Ray, I saw when I was ministering to him, it's interesting, you know, you start catching things. I saw like an angel of the Lord just giving you glasses tonight, and it's Revelation. Specifically, the book of John is going to open up to you like never before, and it's going to open, unlock to you things. And when I was saying that, I saw you holding keys, and the Lord says, you're holding keys that you've been asking for, and they're already in your hand. There's something about John the Lover and John the Revelator that's very distinct for your life. God has something hidden. And as I was saying, I saw Jesus like grabbing your ears too. It's good. It's kind of funny. Like, I heard this phrase, like, I like your ears because you listen. Hi. All right. I'm not a trained professional, but I do know Jesus Christ. And I stayed in Freddie's room. Usually I stay at a Holiday Inn, but next week's a Clarion. I met you on Sunday, didn't I? Yeah. Yeah, you have a, what's your name again? Chris, you have a pastoral call on your life. And are you part of this church? You've been visiting? You need to be a part of this church. But you need to pray about that, because this house, the Lord intends this to be a house of alignment, of divine structure, and Holy Spirit teaching for you to birth the purposes of God. There's a grace on your life to church plant. There's a grace on your life to build. But the Lord says, I always build the man before I build the vision. And I want to build you in this season. And the Lord says, my hand's not too short for you. My hand has not ever left you, even when you thought you were on the wrong path. And I saw you going zigzag, zigzag. It said, but my purpose for you is still alive today. And the Lord says, go home renewed and know that you can live in hope, because I'm with you. And just follow the word of the Lord in this season. And turn, and you'll hear. As you hear, you will listen. And as you listen, it will produce fruit like you've never known. You're facing some things that you really need the Lord to intervene. And he's going to speak really clearly on that. You're a friend of God. And you're an intercessor of God. And the Jesus is standing in front of you tonight. And he's just grabbing your ears. And he said, you've been through some challenging things too, but the Lord says you're about to go on an adventure with him like you've never known. You've walked with the Lord for many years, but you're about to go like on the roller coaster. The picture that I saw was like the roller coaster of the Holy Spirit. It's joyful. It's hopeful. And the Lord says, don't give up on those things. Even just natural things. You might, oh, that's just not important. No. The Lord says, they're important to you. So they're important to me, and I want to fulfill every good thing I've spoken to. I don't know what this means, but the Lord says there's financial windfall coming your way, and more than enough for every good work. And the Lord says, you need to go on a trip overseas. The Lord says, you're not too old to go anywhere. I didn't say that. The Lord said that.
That's all right.
Yeah. The Lord says, you need to go on some short-term trips. India, Brazil, Africa, you need to go, because there's something hidden, not only for your destiny, but there's a blessing that you're supposed to be to other nations. And the Lord says, just go. I'll take care of the bill. I'll pay the bill. I'm calling you to go. I'm not poor. You got a strong healing anointing on your life too. I see you just loving on children, and you're praying for them, and healing happenings. I don't know why. I feel like you have an anointing for educational, like ADHD, things that they've diagnosed children for. God bless you. Yeah, praise God. And you have an angel assigned to you, too. He enjoys being with you. Hey, I do believe I have a message. Yep. Did you have something to say? Like them? They don't make me more anointed, but I do look nicer, don't I? The blue, you know, it's a nice combination, if I do say so myself. All right. Hey, why don't we just lift our hands? Father, you are truly the source of all things. Thank you for everything you've already done. Thank you for bringing me here. Lord, I bless your people's eyes and ears. Lord, I lift off all the people who worked all day, people had things going on. We lift that all off so we could concentrate on what you have for us. Lord, give us the grace to hear. Give us the ability to apprehend what you have for us. Father, I need your help. Fill me with the Holy Spirit. Put your words in my mouth, and I ask that you would be glorified. I ask for miracles to take place tonight. Father, let us capture your eternal purpose for this meeting. Father, none of us in this room just want to do a meeting just for a meeting. We could all go home and watch wrestling, Lord. But so just thank you, Lord, for an eternal purpose for tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. If you have your Bibles, would you turn with me to Mark, the second chapter, scripture I've been meditating on a while here. Mark, the second chapter, verse 18. Start in verse 18. The disciples of John, I'm reading out of the New King James, disciples of John and of the Pharisees were fasting, excuse me. When they came and said to him, "Why do the disciples of John and of the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast?" So I want to pause there for a moment. We want to back up and just look at who is asking Jesus this question. The first group here, and it's interesting, this mix you find here. The first group is John's disciples. John's disciples are obviously followers of the one who God had called to prepare the way for the coming of the Lord. They had to be people of great faith because, in a sense, there was no miraculous demonstration to the ministry of John. It said he did no miracles. So the authority was on the spoken word. It was authoritative preaching, and their hearts came alive, and they were followers. They were followers, and they were on the cutting edge of what God was doing in the earth, where most of the established religious community rejected the call of John as preparing the way for the Messiah. These followed him correctly. And that's important to the context, I believe, of what the Lord would have us understand tonight. Second group is the Pharisees. Literally, they were separate. They were sound in creed, yet their religious system was a form and nothing more. Now, here's a note on the Pharisees. A lot of times, I believe the label Pharisees or legalistic is thrown out way too quick. Usually, especially sometimes the people in our own movement, oh, they're legalists. No, they just believe in a standard. But here's the background on the Pharisees. The Pharisees were the group with the most influence among the people. They were noted for their accurate and therefore authoritative interpretations of the Jewish law, and they had their own traditions and way of life which they were faithful to. The Pharisees, this is important, had a right motive, and that was this. The reason they had developed traditions and the traditions of the law was because they believed that the law that God was giving was the law that God was giving, if the Jew could live righteous, could live properly under that law, that they could hasten the coming of the Messiah. So when Jesus often confronts a lot of, I believe that there's a misunderstanding. Many times when Jesus speaks against the traditions of the Pharisees, he is not opposing what he said, what God declared in the old. He's opposing their interpretation of it. And the reason I point that out is because, in a sense, their motive was correct. They wanted to hasten the coming of Messiah, of Yeshua. So their motive was correct. The way they went about it was totally incorrect. So your motive can be pure, but your paradigm can be incongruent. A lot of people think just because your motive is right, your outcome will be correct. They're like, well, my heart was in the right. It doesn't matter. What was the result? There's a whole group of leaders here in the United States because they think their motive is right, but their paradigm keeps people in bondage. Well, I want to help people. Well, that's not helping them. It's making them poorer. Essential to the training of the Pharisees was the belief that if they could follow the interpretation of the law, they could hasten the coming of the Messiah. In theory, they at least claim to desire the coming of the promised Messiah. I know I just probably threw many of you in a tizzy there. Let me just say this too. There's this kind of popular thought now, like, well, brother, we just go with the words of Jesus. We're not Old Testament people. Well, you have some confusion there, because 2/3 of Jesus' teaching came from the book of Deuteronomy. And God is not schizophrenic like many believers. He wasn't a legalistic God in the old and suddenly became a happy grace person in the new. It was always based on grace. Genesis 15:6. It was accounted unto Abraham that he believed. It made him right with God. I know this might be really controversial. Even under the old, it was still a grace system. Verse 19, and just as a side note, Jesus came to fulfill the law, not to throw it away. I still have not found anyone who can tell me, but brother, we're just on the law of love, no law but love. Really? What's wrong with not cheating on your wife? What's wrong with not coveting your neighbor? Sorry, you have to address these things. And Jesus said, here's what the law required. The law only required fasting on the Day of the Atonement, but many other fasts had been added by religious Jews, especially by groups like the Pharisees, many of whom fasted without water twice a week, especially in the dry season. That is what we call in the Hispanic community local. Fasting was an important practice to join with in prayer and penance. Now, also as key as we look at these verses, Jesus is not opposed to fasting, because in another place in the gospel, he says, when you fast. Yeah. Amen. So he's saying when you fast, meaning he's assuming you're going to fast at some point in your life. So it would have been unusual for the disciples of prospective rabbis to avoid it altogether. A teacher was regarded as being responsible for the behavior of his disciples. So it's actually a legitimate question in one sense. Verse 19, and Jesus said to him, can the friends of the bridegroom fast while the bridegroom is with them? Keep that in mind. As long as they have the bridegroom with them, they cannot fast. But the days will come when the bridegroom will be taken away from them, and they will fast in those days. No one sews a piece of unshrunk cloth in an old garment, or else the new piece pulls away from the old, and the tear is made worse. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins, or else the new wine bursts the wineskins, and the wine is spilled, and the wineskins are ruined. But the new wine must be put into new wineskins. So here, let's analyze in a moment, not fully obviously, but let's look at Jesus' response to this question. And he refers to this season as a wedding. We'll pick that thought up in a minute. Their posture, their question to God is incongruent with the season of what God is doing in the earth, even though one group of those people was at the cutting edge of what God was doing in the earth at one time, which opens up a window of understanding of how the discipleship process operates in the life of a community and a believer. It's always forward motion. You may be on cruise control and think you're living from glory to glory, but in the kingdom, there is no cruise control. Your present choices determine the next day's momentum. That's why you can still have fruit in the kingdom, because it was based on the choices you made 2 or 3 years ago, but you're actually living on cruise control and think you're doing well. And it's important for this house, I just felt this in the spirit, because this is a house of taking ground. This is a house where you don't back down. This is a house where you will not be, like, if you want to be mediocre, there's other places you can go who will feed into your immaturity. So his response is, he begins to talk about a wedding. And I like this because I think we should embrace this in America. During those times, the wedding feast required 7 days of festivity. Freddie, you might want to think about that. One was not permitted to fast or engage in other acts of mourning or difficult labor during a wedding feast. Here, Jesus makes an analogy about the similar inappropriateness of fasting in his own time. And then he calls them friends of the bridegroom. Literally, these were close friends of the bridegroom who served as his attendants. The figure here obviously is used to refer to Jesus' disciples. And then he goes, you don't understand the season you're in. This is a good season of celebration and rejoicing. And then he begins to use this analogy about the wineskins. The tightly sewn skins of goat were often used to hold wine. The fresh skin stretched as the grape juice in it fermented. But the old skins could no longer stretch, so the new wine would cause them to burst. So it was disastrous to put new wine into an old wineskin. Inevitably, the new wine would make the old wineskin burst, and the wineskin would be ruined. So now, let's look back for a moment at their question, because their question is an example of incongruent thinking. Their posture before the Lord made it difficult to receive what God was doing in the earth. So I want to go back to this. Here's something we must all recognize as we walk with the Lord Jesus Christ. We must recognize that every one of us came into the kingdom with a belief in a particular area, whether it's about our family, about God. See, I believe that even unsaved people are theologians. Everyone lives with a philosophy and a way of life. You know, one of the number of questions, you know, especially if people find out on a plane you're a minister, why would God allow suffering in the world? You know, why would God allow, what are they doing? They don't know the Bible, they don't know scripture, but they're a theologian and it defines the way they look at God. And so each one of us, we come into the kingdom with a particular, what we refer to as lens, paradigm, worldview. And that worldview, now, as we come into the kingdom, that worldview, now God wants to take in our walk with him, he wants to begin to line up our worldview. He wants to begin to line up the way we think about our husband, about relationships, about being in a community, about the way we handle money, about the way we handle conflict, about the way we handle people we don't like. He wants it all to line up with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And I said this last night because I believe it so strongly. In your life, there is no demilitarized place in your thinking. You are either thinking like God in a particular area, or you're thinking like the devil. Sometimes there's a network of pastors that I work with in the Philippines, and they love Jesus. They have good motives. But they're a bunch of socialists and Marxists when it comes to money and understanding government and understanding nations. Often our ideas about God are reinforced by ungodly beliefs, a church community, and even a misunderstanding of the nature of God and false teaching. In the name of God, God is often misrepresented by those by even by those who God has used to bring a truth or experience to the body of Christ. For whatever reason, especially the last 100 years, some of the people that were the forerunners in what God was doing in the earth began to criticize the next thing that God was doing. Some of the biggest critics when God began to pour out his spirit among the Baptists and the Episcopalians were the classic Pentecostals, because in their paradigm, their wineskin was not elastic enough to allow the idea that God could actually baptize somebody in the Holy Spirit who drank wine. And then we had what we refer to as the word of faith movement. And just the brilliance, the office of the teacher was coming forth, the truth of the believer, that thank God you don't have to be poor the rest of your life. You know, the gospel's free. Well, the preacher's gotta eat. Only a religious mindset thinks money is not important in the world. But what happened is, as God used these men, there's extremes in everything, but God used these men. But then there came another grace into the earth. It was the strength of the prophetic movement. And some of those same teachers who taught us the word, taught us to stand on the word, they criticized the prophetic movement. So the Pharisees and the disciples of John's worldview was incongruent with what God was doing through the ministry of Jesus. Incongruent thinking will prevent us from living in a continuous outpouring of the Holy Spirit in our individual lives and the lives of our corporate community. It is essential to the world around us that we live in everything that God has ordained for us, because if not, a vacuum will exist. When we partially represent God, it often causes confusion to the world around us. I'm convinced that he's the desire of the nations. It's not that people are not interested in Jesus. They maybe are not interested in what we are displaying of Jesus. What we often refer to as an outpouring of the Holy Spirit or awesome move of God, God refers to as normal. One of the deepest desires of the Holy Spirit is to teach the people of God how to live under an open heaven in which everything he provided for us becomes a reality. Listen to me. In experience and in demonstration. The wine represents the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. The wineskin is what contains the wine. The wineskin must be flexible enough, pliable enough to receive the new wine. One definition, this is how you can certainly define it in a number of different ways, but one definition that we'll focus on tonight is the mind of Christ, which is our operating system for all of eternity. The mind must be in a continual state of transformation for us to be as God intends it to be. Now listen to this, because there's so many people that are obsessed with the new, not realizing that's the kingdom is built truth upon truth, glory to glory, and faith to faith. The new wineskin does not make the old wine obsolete, but is able to contain both the old and the new. Because this is one of the ways that God begins to see. No one has arrived, but this is no one is like, I got it. Like, I get really nervous around people. Like, I got it. It's not really that mysterious to me. Really? No, I know what to do. Okay. Until something really challenging happens. He builds, according to this is one of my favorite verses in Scripture. He builds within us truth upon truth upon truth, but doesn't make the previous understanding that. It just expands our understanding of a specific subject. So if you're not in forward motion, you are not stepping in, you are not a continuous, flexible wineskin, which is really dangerous. Isaiah, the 28th chapter, verse 10. For precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, here, there, a little. We can use many different examples of this, but maybe, for example, you were in an environment where they taught you miracles weren't today. And then you discovered that God actually rose from the dead. And then maybe you were introduced with the idea that God can use certain men or women in the area of healing. You came to accept that as a truth. And then the reality hits you because you read the Bible that not only does God heal people today, but he wants to use you to heal people. So what does he do? Truth upon truth. It expands your understanding of that truth. But that truth must be expressed in your life, or else it's just a religious idea. And you could open up yourself to deception. So it's important to allow ourselves to be continually flexible and pliable, because this is God's promise to us. For he whom God has sent speaks the words of God, for God does not give the Spirit by measure. Why is that a promise to us? Because the promise is always the open heaven, always a continual flow and abundance, always a continual glory to glory. But he needs our hearts and our minds aligned with truth upon truth upon truth. I remember I was in one meeting and it was just a really awesome time in the Lord. And I'm like, Lord, turn up the power again. He said, I can't turn up the power here. I'd wreck this whole church. So we must, and I said this, I don't know, one of the other sessions, we must define our ideas about God from God himself. At the foundation of Jesus' teaching was his desire to transform our thinking so we could receive the complete benefits of the kingdom. These guys, Pharisees of John, Pharisees, they're asking a question that is incongruent in which the season they were in. And it was at the heart, this was at the heart of what Jesus addressed in his ministry. What did he begin preaching? Matthew 4:17. From that time, Jesus began to preach, repent. We know, repent, change your mind, change your direction. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So, at the heart of how God begins to teach us to walk in life, to walk a lifestyle power, to think like him in every area is this. He has a way of operating. His intention is for you to operate that way. But if you won't change, you won't receive the benefit of that grace or that truth. Because he was going, repent. You'll need to shift your thinking, because the reality of my kingdom is available to you right here and now, but I can't make you receive it in your current paradigm. It's possible for a reality to be available to a group of people, but the positioning of their heart shut down their ability to receive what God is doing in there. You know, Mark, the 6th chapter. Remember that one? Jesus is preaching. I want to watch Jesus is preaching one day at Holy Spirit Netflix. I'm hoping Jesus and I can sit like on a piece of stone, like, Lord, let's watch the Sermon on the Mount. Open up verse 5 to me. Tell me what you really meant. No, I said it there, Abner. No. But he begins to preach, and their hearts, because you don't think from here in the kingdom, you think from here. Their hearts begin to go, man, no one has ever taught like that. Man, it's not boring. It has power to it. It has life to it. But then their mind. See, your mind will often try, your intellect will often try and shut down the revelation you're receiving from heaven. And then they began to define what they were hearing by what they knew about him. They go, no, that's the carpenter's son, Joseph. He has never been to Bible college. And I don't even know what his covering is. I'm not mocking those principles, but what I'm saying is God, the enemy will use a biblical idea to shut you down from receiving from what God has from you. Obviously, you know, you should be a part of the community. And it says, Spanish, One Spanish version of the Bible says, Jesus wanted to do miracles, but he couldn't. How could that be possible? Positioning of their hearts. Proper thinking frees us to live in all the possibilities of God. Remember, God's not American. He means everything he says. No, we laugh, but this is one of the cultural obstacles we must overcome. Because when we are not people of our word, it's often a demonstration that we don't believe God is a God of his word. You will manifest the dominant expression of God you've come to know. If you have trouble giving of your finances, it's because you believe that God is cheap with you. And so when we are not people of our word, what we're demonstrating in reality is we don't really believe that God, what God says is true. Jesus, and I say that because I want to read this. Jesus said to her, "Did I not say to you, if you would believe?" So where does the enemy try to erode us in our belief system? If you believe, this is not maybe. This is not if you were at Toronto that opening night. This is not if you know the right revivalist. If you believe, you would see the glory of God. I'm not trying to be funny. Mark 9:23, Jesus said to him, if you believe, trust, steadfast confidence in who he is. If you believe, all things are possible to him who believes. Not to him who's in the fivefold ministry, not to him who got a prophetic word from Bob Jones before he died, to him who believes. Two interesting dissecting things happening there. Proper belief, but also the ability to believe and receive an identity where everything's possible. Most people are convinced that God can do the impossible. They're not convinced he wants to do the impossible through them. Really, that's where the rubber meets the road. So here's some thoughts and questions to ponder. Because I think it's important to analyze these things as we're going on this path to be a... Listen, everything's possible for you because of the one you stand in. There's no situation that he's not big enough to handle. There's no provision he cannot make for you. Do we really want our belief system changed to conform to his reality? Or are we more comfortable with our current experience of who God is for us right now? Sometimes it's almost like many believers, it's like, you know, I know this is not God's best, but I'll take it. If things remain relatively the same from this moment, I know it might not be God's best, but I'm willing to live with it. Never settle for a standard below than what God has promised you. I wrote this down a number of weeks ago when I was just hanging out with the Lord. Sometimes the known of what we have experienced becomes the biggest hindrance to experiencing the next aspect of what God desires for us. I write that, I'll say it again because some of you look like I just talk Chinese. Sometimes the known of what we have experienced becomes the biggest hindrance to experiencing the next aspect of what God desires for us. Oh, this is pretty good. I'll stay here, God. You coming soon? Sometimes we even have our ideas of what it looks like to see God move, and we're comfortable with that. And we're uncomfortable when it doesn't look like that. What if every week for the next 5 weeks, there was no singing, there was no clapping, and all you did was sit here in awe of God, and you didn't even get to prophesy? Because Jesus the prophet was speaking in the room. So, how does the Father change our belief system and shape our belief system? I should rather put it that way. How does the Father shape our belief system? I'm glad you asked. Here's my favorite one. Number one, submission becomes a settled issue. I don't know if you realize, like me, the idea of submission sometimes is a whole lot nicer than actually doing it. Me, not you. Look at Matthew 19, if you would, if you're following along. Fascinating story. Now behold, one came and said to him, "Good teacher, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life?" So he said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God." So Jesus was nicely correcting him. "But if you want to enter life, keep the commandments." And he said to him, "Which ones?" And Jesus said, "You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, honor your father and mother." That's interesting. He's quoting the Ten Commandments. I guess Jesus was Old Testament. "You shall love your neighbor as yourself." Verse 20. And Jesus said to him, "All these things I have kept from my youth. Why do I still lack?" Now here's what's fascinating. In Jesus' response to him, he never tells him, "You haven't kept these." Let's use maybe more of a modern understanding. Jesus, I've gone to the prophetic training. I help out at the food pantry. You know, Jesus, I'm a giver. You know how much I gave at Power and Love. I spend time with you. I pray in tongues. I'll help Pastor Tracy with dinner tonight. See, in our walk with him, I think I said this, I don't know, I just talk. In our walk with him, I've discovered he constantly wants to challenge areas of our life that have a pull or are built out of a wrong foundation, that have our affections or our trust more than him. We know there's not anything wrong with money. He tells us, you know, that's why scripture must be interpreted through scripture. We know there's not anything wrong with money if you look at the whole of scripture. And Jesus said to him, "If you want to be perfect, go sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven." Catch the last part of that, because I always keep this in mind every time God asks me to do something that I'm not really comfortable with, don't really like, doesn't make sense. And he said, "Come and follow me." He always offers you that exchange in that area. for whatever reason, this young man, maybe it was his savings account, maybe it was his 401k that he trusted so much. If anything goes wrong in my life, I know I got that. I know I got that to keep me. So maybe that trust in what he had settled, what he had reserved, he trusted that. If anything went bad in his future, he knew he had that money set aside. Or that money could get him what he needed. And Jesus goes to the heart of it there. You will have treasure in heaven. That's the positioning of every believer. That the decisions we make here, always we must look at it in the sight of eternity. Come and follow me. But when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. He missed an opportunity to walk with the Son of Man because he wanted his stuff more. To catch that exchange there. He had an opportunity. Think about it. How many people wanted to walk with Jesus during that time? And here's the exchange that Jesus offered him. Hey, you can sell everything and then you can be one of my disciples. They'll probably remember you forever. But he never enticed him with the benefit. He just offered him the ability to follow him. So number one, submission becomes a settled issue. And what you'll find is, as we walk, again, no one's perfected, no shame, no blame, but he will constantly challenge those areas of your life that have a pull, that have a love, that have your, that you may have more security in than him. Number two, by continually establishing us in identity. I won't read it, but just for the sake of time, I'll read the last end of it there. 1 Samuel 16, I encourage you to read it. We know it's the story of the prophet of the Lord coming to anoint David to be the next king over Israel. God's voice in the earth comes to Jesse's house at the Dukes of Hazzard. Just checking if you're alive. And something fascinating happens there. I always thought David was this, in a sense, this man of faith, and he was, but I never really understood all the challenges he faced in his own identity. Because his own father, if you read it, his own father... Think about it. If the government of the United States came to your house, maybe when you were growing up and you were still living there, and you knew that they were coming to appoint one of, maybe you had five brothers and sisters, one of your brothers and sisters to be something very important for the next mission, but your parents didn't call you in on it, that would cause you some issues. And so his father goes, "It's this one. It's this one." It's not till, read it, it's not till Samuel asked Jesse, "Is there anyone else?" And most people believe, and I believe, that David was an illegitimate son of Jesse, so he had no rights to any of his father's inheritance. And it's this awesome picture of what happens when God pulls us into the kingdom. Because God himself goes, "I'm about to override every identity root that you ever have right here, and I'm about to anoint you." What are you? A kingdom of you're a kingdom of priests and kings. And in front of his own brothers, the greatest voice in the land at the time goes, "You are called." So God establishes him in this identity. Where does he go? Where is God's training process? He goes, nothing in a sense, in his outward change. Listen to that. Because some of you have the ability already inside of you to shift nations, and it doesn't look like anything on the outside has changed. But it's right in here. He goes back to tending sheep. He goes to playing harp for a guy whose God's grace is left. Next story you read, 1 Samuel 17. I don't know how much time has passed, but this is what happens. Oh, this is powerful. He honors his own father who had already dishonored him. And it's his obedience to his own father, to a man who didn't believe in him, that positions himself to defeat Goliath. Read it. Please go bring your brother some cheese and some bread. Yes, Dad. He went early the next morning. He didn't tell us that, Dad, don't you know who I is? I'm the next king. And obviously you have no discernment, Dad. No, he honored. One of the tests of maturity is that you honor someone who dishonors you. And he shows up and he says, I just think God has this sense of humor. Is this okay? I know going a while, but I'm leaving tomorrow morning. And this champion Goliath, that means he had great victory. This huge man, like Andre the Giant. I mean, it's funny because you have a teenage boy. I always picture it as his voice is probably changing. I'm going to kill you. But when he sees this Goliath, see, once you face a challenge in your journey, the enemy will often attack you in that place of identity. God was trying to establish him as a warrior, and the enemy was trying to establish him in his identity. No demilitarized zone. What happens? His oldest brother goes, I know who you are. So every time you're in the middle of a transition, God wants to reestablish you in the identity that he's given you. So how does God change the way we think? Number one, obedience is, I don't know if I said that properly tonight, but hopefully you got it. If not, ask Darlene. She understood. I'm doing my best, trying to move quick. Number one, obedience is a settled issue. Submission. Thank you. Number two, he continually establishes you in identity. Number three, the Word of God. I encourage you to read Matthew, the 13th chapter. Jesus spends extensive time talking about what happens when the Word comes forth. And the interesting thing about that is there will always be a challenge to God's word in your life. Matthew 13, 23. But he who receives seed on the ground is he who hears the word and understands it, and who indeed bears fruit and produces some 100, some 60, and some 30. What's the point of that? You actually play a role in your own transformation according to how you receive what God is saying. But here's the important part about this. Again, God's got this sense of humor. Like, have you ever noticed that in Genesis, in the creation of the world, God doesn't tell Adam and Eve, he gives them dominion, he gives them this commission to steward the earth, but he never tells them about the devil. He wasn't Pentecostal. He didn't give them a class on spiritual warfare. He didn't say, when you get down there, you're going to need to get the oil and the intercessors together to get the devil out. What's my point there? My point is, when you obey God, you destroy the devil. And so God's goal for us, and you know, like, I understand there is a place of direct confrontation. I'm not discounting that. But I, you know, sometimes people are like, we're gonna uproot the devil. I'm like, I'm good. I have enough challenges by just obeying God. Yeah. Number four, divine encounter is supposed to change us. Talked about that, won't go into it tonight. Encourage you to read Exodus, the 3rd chapter. So number one, submission becomes a settled issue. Number two, God continually establishes us in our identity. Number three, the Word of God. Here's what I forgot to mention about identity. One of the two most important questions about your life: what does God think about me? And how does God think about this area or issue in my life? What does God think about me? And what does God think about this area in my life? They'll define how you face something. Here's the last one we'll discuss tonight. Supernatural displays are supposed to shift our thinking. John, the second chapter. Close with this. John, the second chapter. We know in Luke, the fifth chapter, the disciples left everything to follow God, Jesus. Most of them, most people think they had families, probably some of them had children to take care of. They left everything to follow God. They were forerunners in what God was doing in the earth. And then we know they're at this wedding feast. Jesus turns the water into wine. And then the story concludes with this fascinating statement in John 2. This is the beginning of signs Jesus did in Cana of Galilee, and he manifested his glory. He manifested his glory. Now catch that last thing. And his disciples believed in him. And his disciples believed in him. Why is that interesting to me? It's interesting for this. Because they already believed in him. They already demonstrated their belief in him by leaving everything to follow him. It was the miracle that they saw with their own eyes in front of them that caused them to know that they were on the right path. Catch the interconnectedness there, though. Mary's personal breakthrough became evidence for someone else to believe. Why is it important for you continually to move forward, forward progress, forward momentum, forward in the things of God? Because your breakthrough is supposed to be connected to bringing courage and breakthrough to somebody else. Look, as you encounter God, as you behold his beauty, you're going to see things you've never seen before in the coming months and years. But look at how God speaks and the exchange that takes place, because often it's in the middle of these divine intersections. He's not looking to just speak to you. He's looking to shift your thinking as he addresses you. When Jesus would interact with people, he was ministering on so many different levels. Blind Bartimaeus is a fascinating example. He's going, "Jesus!" So he believed that he was the Messiah. He was also causing himself some problems because he was loud. And here's the thing about it. Jesus did not stop until Bartimaeus cried out for him. So obviously, this beggar, who most people don't believe is the Messiah, this beggar goes, "It's Jesus!" And Jesus is going, "Oh, that's pretty good. You believe I'm the Messiah." Then he comes to him, and he goes, "Bring him to me." So they bring him to him, and Jesus goes, "What is it that you want?" First thing that happened there is Bartimaeus needed an identity shift, because we know the cloak that he wore there was that of a beggar. It identified him as a beggar. So in approaching Jesus, Jesus was shifting his identity. You don't have to beg anymore. But it didn't stop there. Jesus said to him, "What do you want?" Fascinating. I have a big mouth. I would go, "Jesus, hey, come on, bro. Like, the guy's blind." I want to suggest to you that Jesus probably knew that the man was blind. But it was his inner, watch your interactions with him. Because it's in his voice, he's trying to get to some of your thought process. He was trying to tell him, now that you've left that identity as a beggar, you've been used to getting things from people your whole life just at their own mercy. But here's what I want to show you. Not only have you shifted your identity, but I want to show you that it's your faith in me that can cause you to receive things from me. What would you like? I'd like to receive my sight. Go, because your faith has made you well. He wanted to show him it wasn't just about Jesus healing him. It was about a complete shift in identity that he could live from that moment forward. Because the brilliance of Jesus is he doesn't want to just leave you. Oh, let me do a miracle for you. He always wants to empower people to receive what is available inside of them as they partner with God. And that's what God has for you. I want you, when you go home or tonight, look at your life. Many of you don't. He always puts something in your hand that is a key to unlock your breakthrough. And you may go, I don't have it. Yeah, so did the widow. What do you? I got oil. I'll take that oil. And he goes, I'll take that oil. See, not only does he give you Genesis 1, back to Genesis 1. He always gives you a seed for your breakthrough. And you may think it's insignificant, but in the hands of God, it's a tool for your future. Because he always wants to empower you to use what's in your hand. What do you have in your hand? And I just felt tonight that the Lord wanted us to explore this for a little bit because the grace and the calling on this house is great. And it's always going to be forward motion. And you never want to be on cruise control in the purposes of God. And you always want the ability to approach the Lord in proper context. Because it's I don't know how to say this, but God is always desiring to intervene. His hand is never too short. But our approach to him can pervert what he desires to do. So Lord, thank you tonight for this great group of people who you've called together for such a time as this. And I declare that there's breakthrough coming for the people of God in this room. And I say that the keys of breakthrough, the keys of the kingdom are already in their hand. The keys to the unlocking of destiny, the keys to the unlocking of prophetic words, the keys to unlocking of provision, the keys to unlocking unsaved relatives is already in their hand. And thank you, God, that Jesus ever lives to make intercession on our behalf. And Jesus always prays the perfect will of God. So Lord, teach us how to abide in that dialogue of heaven. Teach us how to hear what you're saying so that we may declare what you're saying in heaven and see it in a reality upon the earth. And the Lord says to the group of people here today, I want to teach you how to walk in grace. I want to teach you how to see all grace abound towards you. And I want to teach you how to see answer upon answer upon answer upon answer to prayer. For many are the promises over this house. And the Lord says, I am releasing a sound and a wind over this house in a unique way to teach you how to overcome everything that stands in front of you. No longer say one day, but say this is the day that the Lord has made. For great, great, great is the call. And great, great is the purpose. And great, great is the provision for the people in this place. And you will be a sign. You will be a sign in this region. You will be light in the middle of darkness. You will destroy even what other previous movements have not been able to destroy. You will uproot and you will plant the kingdom of God. And you will be an example of the goodness of God. You will be an example of the joy of the Lord being your strength. And you will be an example that all things are possible. Just put your hands on your ears. Father, I bless the ears of your people to hear as they've never heard. I bless them with grace to adjust to every good thing you speak to them. Father, I declare that they have the mind of Christ. I declare that the brilliance of the multifaceted wisdom of God would be displayed through their life. I declare, as they think, so are they. So I bless them to think from a heavenly place. I say, no obstacle is too big. No mountain is too high. I declare that as they speak your word, it'll be like John the Baptist, that you're making crooked places straight. I declare that the sound released from these people in this room would make way the coming of the Lord. And I declare that there will be a roar through the people of God in this room, a roar of revival, a roar of reformation, a roar of the way it's what it looks like to do life in the earth. I declare uncommon ideas. I declare healing through these people's hands. Not just one, but many. Many. I declare those they said will not live will live through the hands of the people here. I declare that they are the eyes and the ears of God in this region. I declare that their feet will walk on water. I declare that the passion of their heart would be to know you. I bless them with the glories that you have available, the riches that are available in you. I bless them with great intercession. I bless them with tongues they've never known. I bless them with prophecies they haven't spoken. I bless them to be the sons of the prophets of the Most High God. May they take land. May they prosper in every good work. And may they say, truly, we have never seen the Lord do things in our midst. And he has fulfilled every good promise he has given to us. And may a generation come behind them that says, we are so thankful for the choices these people made. For they have made Glen Burnie and the region around a better place. We have seen the Lord Jesus because there was a generation of people who chose to believe God. May you never settle for a religious idea of God. May you never settle for a good service. May you never settle for a good song. But may you always be on the crest of what the Lord has for you. May wave upon wave upon wave of the river that resides in heaven reserved for you be your and your children's inheritance. If you receive this word, why don't you just stand? Ramba kata mandarabahaya. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hambahatarabahaya. Father, may the prophecies of old that others could not fulfill, that was aborted, come alive. May this house inherit the grace and the mantles that men and women went to the grave with in this region. That some moved out of this region and they couldn't fulfill. May this region be established under the banner of the lordship of the kingdom of God. May you raise up true apostles and prophets in this region. May you raise up a people who take ground. May you raise up people who will never bow to a religious devil. May intellectualism bow to the name Jesus. And may Jesus be glorified. If you receive this word, 1, 2, 3, I just invite you to the front. Just put your focus on him. He's the one who's going to touch you. Thank you, Lord.
As Abner gets ready to move in the prophetic, not only is this an on-time word, but I think it's really important that you understand the gravity of what he's saying, because I definitely sense not only are we in a significant shift and transition, what's going on right now is the Lord is going to bring in, he's going to bring in new wineskins that can replace the ones that can't stretch. Constantly challenging our minds to a new season. And it was proven last night at Darlene's, because that's why I was so amazed, because the mindset of a couple people around me have shifted so drastically. The Lord's saying, I'm bringing those people that weren't prepared in a season for a season you're prepared for now. And what's happening, if you heard the prophecy on Sunday morning, it's like just like this. And I told someone this morning, I actually was talking about the wineskins. I said, there's some wineskins that are done stretching. They got it figured out for a season. Listen carefully. There are some wineskins, even right now under the sound of my voice, you've got it figured out for a season. You know how God works. You know how church works. You know how pastors should be. You've got so many things figured out that it's all in little categories, and God is ready to mow down the categories. I said, where we're going, you won't actually even be able to put your intellect around what you knew yesterday will not even fit into tomorrow's paradigm. So what God will do is he'll say, hey, we have to shift some things around, because where you're going, some people won't be able to go with you. And so we have to all be flexible for that mindset, that shift. I constantly have to allow the Lord to give me upgrades, because I don't want to be stuck. It's easy to get stuck. Some churches today are living on John the Baptist's revelation. Repent, the kingdom of God's at hand. No, the kingdom of God is here. It's already here, and we're still living on the repentance phase. Not that the repentance phase is bad, it was good, and so was the Old Testament. But we have to keep going from glory to glory, constantly moving and marching under the sound of God's voice. So I pray that today, tonight, as Abner ministers, that there's a grace to let go of the old wineskin, because I believe God's going to shake everything that can be shaken. And if you're shakable and it shakes you out, if it shakes you out, it's okay. We understand. If you gotta go, you gotta go, because it's time for us to move forward. If you gotta go, you gotta go. I'm tired. I'm not gonna be moved by people that gotta go. Be shaken. Let it shake you. We need to move forward. It's time to move forward. It's time for us to get a right opinion of God's order and God's strategy for a new season we're walking in, which is a season of leaders raising up to raise other leaders. It's not mom and pop ain't doing it no more. We're done. We're as far as we could stretch. Look at this. This is a Tuesday night, guys. We are blessed beyond our measure, and now it's time for your measure to be added. You hear me? So, Lord, we just thank you for everything you're going to release right now in this prophetic time. Amen.
Thank you, guys. Hey, just lift your hands. You know, there's going to be some words given. I'm not going to discount that, but just the main focus, there's a call in my life for impartation, transfer the anointing. What I really want to pray is that you would be released into an encounter, a series of encounters, and God knows what you need, so I'm not saying you're not going to get a word or anything like that, but this main focus is just on the release of the anointing. And the reason I say that, if you don't get a word, don't try and define it as, oh, I didn't, just define it by receiving from the Lord. I'm just the mailman. But I am confident God's going to blow through this room. I'm confident in the God who's called me. So just lift your hands. I'll pray for this platform, then we'll pray for each of you who'd like prayer. Holy Spirit, thank you for the open heaven here tonight. Thank you for the angels of God that are here. Thank you that you've sent them as ministering spirits. Thank you for the angel of fire. Thank you for the angel of revelation. Thank you for touching people's eyes, touching people's hands, touching people's feet. Father, thank you for releasing a baptism of fire. Thank you that you promised the Holy Spirit baptism of fire that replaces. And Lord, I thank you for breaking people free of things that have held them back. Father, I thank you for a stepping forward into that open door. I'm just going to count to three and just take one step forward because we step into that open door. One, two, three. Whoa. Father, we step into that door. We go from glory to glory. We go from faith to faith. Father, I just believe that word that you gave me many years of my life that'll go around the world and be a carrier of revival. So thank you that you've been faithful to do that. Thank you for doing it tonight in Glen Burnie. And I just say, increase your power, Holy Spirit. Increase your power, Lord. We ask that you would be glorified. More, Lord. More, Lord. I just had this sense that some of you, like in your mind, you're like, we do this all the time. And the Lord says, no, you haven't done this one before. So I bless you to receive what God's pouring out here tonight, to have a sense of expectation. Father, we expect from you. We raise our expectancy to what you desire to do. So we just say, come, Holy Spirit. Come with your power. More, Lord. More, Lord. If we could have some guys help me just stand behind people. More, Lord. Just say this. Say, Father, I receive everything you have for me. No matter what it looks like. I'll be a fool for you. Valerie, I bless you. Fire! Whoa, fire. Fire, fire. Stay focused on him. If we could play a CD or something, some music, stay focused on him.